Okay, welcome to Inside the Noize. My name is Jenna Heidemann, and we have Dave Kuncio with us.
Nailed it. Kuncio. It's like Rufio, kind of.
Like, are you trying to do Rudy?
No. What's the movie?
Rufalin.
It's like Rufio. 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 It's in Hook with Robin Williams.
Rufio is like the Peter Pan movie. Yeah. Robin Williams from Peter Pan.
You've never seen Rufio?
I feel like I have this conversation at least twice a week. I have not seen the most important movies I should have seen growing up. Like, I've missed out on so many.
Robin Williams was the best Peter Pan.
I had to watch it.
Tremendous movie.
It was better than the cartoon version. Like, didn't Disney make the...
Oh, I mean, yeah, I think they've done a couple since.
Yeah.
Yeah, I need to get on that.
But for the listeners, I'm Dave Kuncio, but a lot of people say Kuncio. Take that as you will.
And, quit trying to church it up.
Yeah, Kuncio. Like Rufio.
All right.
Now we're in it.
Now we're in it. We're ready. Yeah. Each week we start off with make some noise, stop that noise, like a good week, bad week.
Okay.
I'll share mine first. My bad week is I bought this expensive deodorant, and it's like supposed to be organic and like great, and I've been using it for like 4 weeks, and I have BO all the time.
Oh, it's the worst.
You're supposed to do this. Did you try it too?
I've done like the Toms, I think, was like.
I tried Kopari.
You buy it on Amazon and stuff. It's like.
I got it one time because I learned that aluminum is bad.
Yes.
So I stopped doing that and then I tried the best
deodorants have like high, like, or the quote unquote best deodorants.
Doesn't work.
It's like a $15 deodorant.
No. It's a scam.
I've been using it, and I was at a conference yesterday, and then I went to a showcase, and I was like, I smell. Like, I need to go home because I can't be around people. And there's a lot of people packed there, and it was like sweaty already. I'm like, I gotta leave.
Yeah.
I can't be here. So now I need to get a new deodorant, and I was trying to be healthy and use
like
the natural deodorant, and it's been about 4 weeks, and it still doesn't work well.
Yeah, no.
Yeah.
No, after the first try, instance of smell, I would have been out.
I never had like real bad BO, but I sweated like crazy. And I read up on, you know, the aluminum.
Yeah.
And I was like, aluminum is why I'm sweating. And I bought the $20 deodorant, and it was even worse.
Like, I don't know if other people might not have noticed, but like, I was just self-conscious of it. Cause I'm like, oh, my deodorant.
Mm-hmm. No one ever notices.
This is terrible.
I mean, I can smell when someone has BO, but I'll be the first to know that I have BO though too.
Okay. Yeah.
I was a big Old Spice guy, and then that had aluminum in it. And then, so I switched over. I've been using, I think it's Dove. Yeah. I use Dove for men.
Okay.
No aluminum, smells great, works great, but it says, okay, it's still a scam. Deodorant, I guess, is a scam because it says 48 hours of protection, and like, no way is this protecting me for 48 hours.
Maybe if you sit on your couch and don't move for 48 hours.
Yeah, maybe.
And it might.
So.
Well, yeah, that's my bad. We like, stop that noise. No more organic deodorant for me.
Yeah,
I'm going back to like the normal stuff that costs like $5. Like,
you gotta get that secret. I'm not lying.
I used to wear men's deodorant.
Yeah, yeah. I know guys that have worn women's deodorant.
you know one right here.
Yeah.
Oh boy. And then my good week, my make some noise is I did go to this event the other night, and I've always struggled with open bar events, and I only had 2 drinks, and I was very classy.
Oh, excellent.
So I'm really proud of myself.
All right, yeah. Held it together.
And I had a bottle of water after I had my second glass of wine. I'm like, okay, now I need to go home.
Yeah.
But that's my good week.
Excellent.
All right.
Do we go around and...
I don't have any part in this.
Okay.
It's all about
you're just kind of like peanut gallery in a way, like kind of chirping in here and
pretty
there.
Pretty much.
All right, excellent. All right, good week, bad week. Oh, God. Bad week. Okay, I'm a procrastinator, clearly. And this will tie into it'll both be the same sort of thing. For instance, okay, so here it is. Last night I had this dinner party, and it was a death row dinner party based on basically what your last meal would be if you were about to like get the chair or whatever. Everybody was told to bring a certain dish. Mine was cream spinach. Now I was planning on cooking it myself and making it. I had the recipe, whatever. But yesterday, day of, hadn't made it yet. Hadn't even done a trial run with it yet. I've never made it before. So, long story short, like, it gets the 11th hour, and I'm like, I need to get it. And I tried looking up where you get cream spinach. I couldn't find any at the grocery store, and it's typically a steakhouse thing. And so I'm calling steakhouses, and crunch time settled on Morton's, and you know, I was like, how much does one serving, you know, feed? And it's like 2 to 3 people, and I had 14 people coming. So I got like 5 servings of this and spent like $80 on cream spinach.
$80 worth of goodness?
We still have a bunch of it left. Oh, yeah, it was good. It was really good. And I totally told people that I just made it myself. But but no, it was, that was the thing where it's like, I could have made this if I had just properly, you know, put time aside for it and saved myself probably, I don't know, $70? That was a little hit that I took, but the silver lining, I guess, was that I had this amazing dinner party that we had been kind of planning for a long time based off that
actually been planning the
I think the email or the not the text chain started like 3 weeks ago, so it was like in the, you know, people knew it was a thing.
Yeah.
I didn't send out the invites. I was just kind of the host, so we had it at my house. But it was my question that was posed to my friends out here for a number of years now. So it's been a long time coming for this thing to happen. We've been talking about it for a while. So it was nice to kind of see it come to fruition and have the inaugural Death Row dinner last night. So I guess that was my good week, bad week.
That sounds like something I want to go to.
Yeah.
No, I think it's going to, I mean, I would like
it.
It's
going to be a thing.
Yeah. It was a test run last night, smaller group. We had way too much food. You probably could have cut it in half. But it was good to kind of test. Well, nobody wants
to eat a lot when they go to an event with a lot of their friends. Like, I don't know. Right. Maybe it's
just me.
And
there's so much that was probably there that you probably just, like, picked up things.
You know, you're picking, you're snacking here and there, and it just, you know, by, like, the third dish, you're like, oh, God, I did not time this out correctly. My eyes were bigger than my stomach.
Yeah, like, I filled up on this homemade cream spinach, and I'm missing out on taking the blankets down there.
My buddy's girlfriend made these little kind of like cheesesteak wontons, and those came out first, and like we just eat. I just had like 6 of those before like the meal started, and I was like, whoops.
So was it like a dinner for schmucks, like that kind of thing?
No, I would love to go to something like that, though.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Man. I'd probably be the schmuck, though, that was brought by somebody. So, yeah.
Oh, man. Okay, so that was a good week.
Yeah.
It's Halloween tomorrow. Are you dressing up?
No, I'm not. I'm going to go to the haunted house that's like 10 minutes from here. Like Nashville Horror Night type thing.
Yeah. I've seen it advertised. I don't mess with haunted houses.
I don't do that either.
No. Oh, really? If there's like 7 haunted houses. One, you have to like sign a waiver or something. Like I love scary movies. I love Halloween. I love dressing up too. But this year, well, I didn't really fit into the costume that I wanted to wear. For the past 2 years, I've been this like 70s like narcos guy, like this drug dealer sort of like, you know, cartel sort of looking dude. And, you know, I moved to Nashville and put on a little weight and went to try on the costume that day. And it fit, but not, it didn't really fit as well as I would have liked it.
No, you just got to unbutton like the top 3 buttons.
I kind of
like
sabotaged my whole going out and dressing up thing because I was... That was the plan. I was like, oh, yeah, I'm just going to be the thing I was last year. It's a big hit. And then once I realized it was kind of too late. So kind of diverted the plan. Going to go.
So is that your bad week? You didn't fit, you didn't fit in your
costume? Add that to it as well. Yeah.
You didn't fit in
the costume. Yeah, exactly. Did not fit into the costume. I took like, and I have pictures from when I was in it like years, a couple years ago. And I did a comparison. It's just ugly. It's bad.
Oh, oh no. Yeah.
So, I went to Barry's boot camp yesterday.
It's the biscuits and gravy, man. I don't get that.
I mean, whatever. It's like the freshman 15, I guess. So, what are you going to do?
Yeah, I coach at a gym called Hotbox.
Oh, really?
So, you should come by sometime.
I'm in. I've been doing class pass stuff, and it's almost up. So, I'm going to keep, you know.
Come try. It's hot kickboxing. It's kickboxing in a hot room with intense rap music
playing. We used
to
do kickboxing in college. I played college football, and our off-season training involved a lot of kickboxing.
Interesting.
And it was... devastating. It was so hard. So I haven't done kickboxing since. Scarred. But I'll do it.
Okay, yeah. Come by some. We just moved locations. So yeah, it's like a dope gym now.
You don't need gloves or anything, right? You just kind of go and...
You'll get gloves when you
go
there.
We'll give
you gloves.
Oh, all right. Yeah. Yeah, I'll do it.
Yeah, come on over. Okay, so you're newer to Nashville. Kind of give us, like, and the listeners, like, your backstory and, like, how you got here and what you've been doing the last few years.
So I've been in L.A. for the past... 8 years or so. Moved out right after I graduated college, signed a co-pub deal, kind of got right into songwriting, fortunately enough. started getting some cuts in the pop world. Then that moved from like pop to R&B and got some stuff going in there. And then I, what led me to Nashville was actually a track that I had done originally for Ty Dolla $ign. I don't know if you guys are fans of his, but he's pretty big in the pop and R&B world.
Dolla $ign?
Dolla $ign? Dolla $ign. Shout out Ty Dolla $ign.
I'm so country. Like, I don't
really?
Know.
Really? You don't know Ty Dolla? You definitely know his voice.
I thought you mispronounced Ty Dolla $ign.
No, no. You know Ty Dolla $ign? No. Ty, really? You definitely would know his songs for sure. He's like the hook guy. Like, he's on, you know, he was on that song Work From Home. Mm. He's been like on a lot of like pop songs, like as like the cool like rap feature.
Okay.
But he's a singer, he's not really a rapper. I actually have a song coming out with him in a few months.
That's awesome. I have to check him out.
Yeah, you should. We've got some cool joints together. But I was working on this track, I was working on his album, and I had this track with this really slinky, boozy guitar riff. And basically it ended up in the hands of another producer friend of mine. We had worked together and I'd played him the idea, and then we kind of collaborated on the beat, and he was like, I'm going down to Nashville next week. He's like, can I bring this with me? He's like, I think they'll love this down here. And I was like, all right, yeah, cool. And then a few weeks later, I get a call that a couple writers hopped on it, and they had had this Summer on a Beach concept kicking around, and it was this kind of perfect marriage between my track and their song, and it became Summer on a Beach for Dierks Bentley. And so
had you heard of Dierks Bentley before?
Yeah, I had. I knew who Dierks was. I wasn't like as familiar with the country scene at the time.
Did you know that like he was going to take that to those like Dierks writers, or like did you know who were the writers it was going to?
Oh, no. No, not at all. I just knew my producer buddy, Alex, who had been working with them for some time.
That's awesome, man. It's just completely organic.
Yeah. And it's very unconventional for how songs get cut down here. Yeah. But but it threw me into the scene. I started, you know, the song took off, and it was way, I didn't know it was going to be as big as it was. And I actually thought it was my original track was going to be on the final version, because I was kind of out of the loop on that. And so when it was premiered, I was expecting to hear my track and like his vocal. And then it was completely reproduced.
It was Nashvilleized.
And it was Nashvilleized. But at first I was kind of like taken aback. I was like, like it? And then like the second time around, I was like, this is a monster. I was like, this sounds awesome. So
Definitely like a comeback song for Dierks.
Yeah, that's what they, I think it took his career to, he was already, you know, he had a lot of success up until that point, but I think this kind of like pushed him into that sort of like stratosphere of, you know, headliner type guy and you know, stadium tour, and they named the tour after the song. And that's when I was like, whoa, this is nuts. Like, it's called the Summer on a Beach tour. I was like, this is crazy.
Do you get any kickbacks from it being named after the song?
I asked about that. I know you get like, if an artist is on tour and they're playing your song every night, you get some.
But
just I don't know. Like, merch, I was like, we should get some merch.
He does this, like, somewhere on a beach at his festival in Colorado. He
does, I don't know. But, yeah, it definitely, like, kind of gave him, like, a new, like, not like a rebranding. I think it just kind of solidified that song. Just, I don't know, his whole vibe. Like, totally.
In Nashville, he had come out of the limelight for a little while because he did a bluegrass album.
It wasn't received.
It was very well critically acclaimed. Yeah. It's just not going to get on the radio.
Yeah.
That was after Drunk on a Plane.
It was right before Drunk on a Plane.
Because everyone's like, "Oh, this is like the sequel to Drunk on a Plane."
Yeah.
It was like a good little sequel to it.
Yeah. But I don't think that was intentional.
Drunk on a Plane got him started on his kind of back into the mainstream.
Right.
And then Somewhere on a Beach just stamped it.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm very, very thankful to be a part of that. So I started coming down here about 3 years ago, and just the community was amazing to be around and other writers and kind of see how things get done around here. And it was very eye-opening, but I was kind of determined to prove myself. I didn't, because, you know, everyone's like, oh, you're a track guy. And I was like, what's a track guy? Like,
that's what I was going to call you. And I don't write songs and I'm not in that world, but I'm like, you kind of sound like what they call a track guy.
Yeah.
Same thing in my head. I was just like, don't ask him.
And so like, you're a track guy. I was like, not really. Like, that particular instance, I guess I was the track guy, but... no, I definitely have always thought of myself as a writer first and foremost. Like my favorite position in a write is usually to be the guy on the couch with the guitar who's spitting out ideas and coming up with riffs and stuff that's going to like spark a song and then help you write the song. Yeah. So for that, I was like, all right, but I'm cool with that. And I hear it's, you know, it can be beneficial to be one. So it's like, yeah, I'll make tracks if you need me to do that. But when I started coming down here, it was very much like, you know, we're songwriters and like, you better put up or shut up, and in a good way. It was supportive, but like, my, for instance, the first, like, my guys who are my best friends out here now, I had written with them the day of and met them, Nick Wayne, okay. Right? I wrote with Nick Wayne and we finished our write and he called his girlfriend Hannah and he was like, Hannah, I met this guy. It was like, you're gonna love him. And so they invited me out later that night because they had a round, Nick had a round at the listening room and at the old location. And
oh, okay, Second Avenue.
Yeah. Yeah. And so before the show, I met Hannah, I met Josh Kerr and kind of that group that, you know, has kind of become like that, a staple of listening room. And they're like, yeah, come out. They're like, you should play your song tonight. And I was like, oh yeah, sure. I'm like, what do you mean? And then I didn't think it was serious. And then about like an hour into the show, Nick's like, hey, I made a new friend today and he's got a song out right now that y'all might know, and we're gonna have him come up here and play it. And I was like, my heart sank. I was like, what? And like, had not drank enough at that point. Had never even performed the song.
I was like, did you know all the
live?
Lyrics?
I knew the song, but I was like,
you probably hadn't played it since you did the track.
Yeah, I wasn't like practicing it or anything like that. I was never thought I was gonna be performing it live. But I learned real quickly in that moment because I got up on stage. I had to do it. I was like, all right, well, gotta do it. And I get up on stage, and the four of them leave the stage. And it was just me up there, and I was like, what? So I do it. It was horrible, because I, like, heard myself back in the monitors, because I'm nervous, and it was just, like, couldn't breathe. It was terrible. Yeah. And then I, like, kind of, like, you know, just wandered off stage afterwards. Yeah. Like, head out. I was like, get the hell out of here. Like, I hated it. I didn't hate it, but, like, I was just, like, embarrassed, because I wanted to, like, if I'm going to do something, I want to, like, crush it and, like, be good at it. And they were so good at, like, they were so natural up there, and they've done it a bunch. And to have me go up there with this, like, massive song and, like, completely, like, not deliver on it, like, just have give some, like, half-assed, like, you know, version, I was kind of embarrassed. So, anyways, Nick had a round the following night, and he's like, you want to do your song again? I was like, yeah.
I'm ready.
I drank a little bit more tequila that night, and I went up there, and it was a much better performance. But I learned real quick that... like, if you're a songwriter in this town, or you say you write songs, like, you better, and you have cuts or whatever, you better be able to play them, because it's like, and I love that, actually, because in LA, it's not really like that. Everyone's, like, kind of hiding behind, they don't want, there's not a lot of, things for people to showcase the fact that they've written these songs or whatever, and it's just way different, but I kind of loved it, and I was kind of hooked after that, so now I'm starting to do some rounds, and now that I live here, and get real into it, so... That's awesome. I definitely think it's kind of like a rite of passage.
Yeah.
So it was very eye-opening, but I think great from like it's a great learning experience. So
it's just the one thing that stood out to me is you said they all like got off stage. Jenna's a kind of a staple over at Listening Room too. She's there all the time, and I've been there a bunch, and I've seen a ton of people get called up like that, but I've never seen everybody leave the stage.
Yeah, I don't know if they did that intentionally either, but it was like very like, welcome to Nashville. And I was like, all right, okay.
Like, I heard there's a big sense of community.
Let us just leave them high and dry up there. Yeah. I just remember being like, why are you guys leaving?
Yeah, man.
And I don't know you well enough at this point to be like, get the hell back here.
Come on back now.
So, yeah. But, I've definitely been wanting to kind of prove myself as just kind of an all-around writer and producer, I guess, but just more like a guy that can help get you songs. So
that's awesome, man.
Because I didn't want that stigma.
Nashville's better to have you.
Yeah. Are you writing every day? Or like, what's your...
For the most part, I mean, I'm trying to.
Yeah.
But some weeks are more, you know, some weeks are busier than others. But yeah, that was another thing. I just saw opportunity coming down here. Every time I'd come down, I'd write with great people, and then they'd become my friends, and like it just became way easier to contact them and set up rights. And then I just, you know, you basically end up working with your friends all the time. And all my friends in LA weren't in music, whereas all my friends here are in music. And so,
oh, that's different.
I'd be coming down like quarterly, and like every time I'd come, I'd be like, this place is amazing. I have way more fun down here. I get way more work done, and I'm happier, and I'm like working with my friends. So just kind of came to a tipping point where I was like, I'm just moving. I'll just flip it. I'll make trips to LA if I want to. But it just seemed like this is where I should be. I just felt very much a part of a community of supportive people, and it's been awesome. So, but yeah, I'm trying to write a lot. I mean, everyone books out like super far in advance.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I've been able to keep myself pretty busy, and like while I'm like planting my feet and like kind of getting settled in. So I've only been here officially like 2.5 months, I think.
Okay. What are some
almost 3 months actually.
What are some of your favorite spots in town?
Favorite spots, the listening room. Love the listening room. I like Red Door. As I'm sure a lot of people,
I'm a big Red Door person.
I live in East Nashville. I like Red Door East too. It's completely different vibe than
Midtown.
Than Red Door, yeah, Midtown. They have the golf game.
Oh, the Golden Tee.
Yeah.
Where else do I like to go?
You ever hang on to Mumbrian? Like Tin Roof?
I've been to Tin Roof a few times. I want to go more. It seems like it's always kind of wild there.
I mean, it depends on the night you go, but there's something going on.
And like when I was living in LA, my lifestyle was like way like kind of different. I wouldn't really go out during the week, and I wouldn't like drink as much. I'd maybe drink on like a Friday and Saturday.
Welcome to Nashville.
Everyone drinks during the week, and you stay home on the weekends.
Well, I like that though, because
I think everybody in LA didn't drink as much because they were all high too. Yeah,
everybody's high.
Yeah,
everyone's just walking around high. No, for real, everyone's out to lunch. But the lifestyle's been a little different, but I love it. It's fun. I'm not like an alcoholic or anything, but like I'm fine. There's more things to do. Like
there's so always much to do.
You know, tonight I was gonna go check out this show for this artist that my buddy writes for, and like it's just things that are going on that are easy, that are accessible, and you know, I don't know, your friends are gonna be there. There's just stuff to kind of keep yourself occupied. So I really have been enjoying myself. And I don't think it's like a honeymoon phase either, because I've been coming down here for like 3 years. I've been to all the spots. It's, you know, nothing's like new to me really. It's more like I live here officially. But
yeah,
like I'm really enjoying myself. So now I hope to continue. Everyone else seems to be enjoying themselves.
You're gonna feel the exact same way. Five years from now, I think so too.
Yeah.
I'm from New Jersey, so like even like it's raining today. I love that it's raining and like it's gloomy and kind of chilly and. There's seasons here.
Yeah.
Because I was living in like the twilight zone out in LA. It's 75 and sunny every day, and like time just flies.
It's kind of hard to write a like, you know, a gloomy song when
it's
never
weird
gloomy.
Though. I was like depressed. Like you find yourself like, it's like the same day over and over, and you kind of get lost in the shuffle and you don't know what time, like, you know, years went by. And I was like, wait, that was like 2 years ago? It seems like it was like Tuesday. I was like,
Groundhog's Day.
Really weird. So. It's nice to kind of not be in that currently, and I feel like, you know, maybe it's like I'm hypersensitive because I'm new-ish, and I'm like, oh, wow, like everything is like kind of, you know, bright and shiny right now, but yeah, no.
Okay, I have a game to play because you're new to Nashville. You guys can play against each other, but I heard you're not great at old country songs. I heard you're pretty bad at being able to identify them and who sings them. So
okay.
I just have about 10 songs that were number ones and everyone should probably know from the 90s.
Oh, God.
Like,
this is going to completely just discredit me in this town.
I'm not going to play because I don't want
to. You have to play. I'll let him answer.
He's going to know everyone, probably.
Well,
either song title or even the artist. I'll say either one.
Okay.
So either song title or artist. And you get, I'm going to play you like 30 seconds.
When you say old, how old?
90s.
Oh, okay.
Like 90s country.
Okay. And like you're going to play me the song?
Yes, I'm going to play you the song.
Okay. And I've got to do what? I've got to guess the title of the song and the artist?
Yes.
If possible?
If possible. I'm going to give you about 30 seconds of the song. That's probably too much. You should know it in the first. you tell me when you know it so like we can just compare. Yeah. Okay.
That's not fair.
Okay. Three. Here's the first one.
Okay. I gotta hear the guy sing. It might be a girl. Hold on. Maybe all I got is this beat up leather bag. Okay, I guess you can stop it at this point. Because is it George Strait?
It is.
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
Okay.
You're one for one. Katie?
Bonus points if you can name the song.
Oh. Nah.
Should have waited for like the chorus.
Yeah, I could. I wasn't going to do that to myself. I don't.
In your love with me.
Yeah. No.
You're in your love with me, George
I'll take,
Strait.
I'll take the name. Okay, I'm glad I got the name.
You got 1 point there. Okay. All right. Next one. Okay, you know this one.
This is this Brooks and Dunn?
I'm a brand new man.
Brand new man, Brooks and Dunn. All right, wait, let's go back to the beginning of that song for a second, because I...
You want me to play it again?
Well, yeah, just the first line, and I made the connection. So, all right, what does that remind you of?
Hank Williams.
What else does it remind you of? Current song. Biggest song of the year. Country song.
I don't listen to the radio anymore. I saw the light of sunrise back in the 40
on the muddy riverside getting baptized and holy. Yeah. Go to the tape.
You want
to
play it again?
Yeah, I'm saying it.
Oh, no, you're gonna get caught out. Baptized by the muddy
riverside on the muddy riverside. Yep. Oh,
God's country.
Damn, shots fired.
No. I think
I'm just
when I heard that song, I was like, whoa. I was like, what does that remind me of? But I think that's cool. I that whole like biting of this and that, I think it's just I think it's more of an interpolation.
I think you might have been the first person to make that correlation.
Yeah.
Really?
Out of the millions of people in Nashville. Song is
I have a knack to do that, and I've been like, you know, my friends
got
like,
a super ear.
My friends are like, you're like a human jukebox when it comes to that type of stuff. So I've actually kind of dialed it back because I'll find myself in writes where we're writing and someone will sing a melody and I'll be like, that's like Natalie Imbruglia or whatever. Yeah. Like I'll like say something like I'll hear it. Like the other day, there's a song that we were playing and somebody sang the melody of, you know, there was this artist called Paula Cole back in like the 90s who like did the Dawson's Creek theme song. And the guy was singing the melody. I was like, "That's that song." And then we listened to it back and forth, and it was the same.
Man.
But I'm trying not to do that as much because it's like kind of ruins the moment. It's like, who cares? Because like that, you like might,
like that guy,
it might, yeah. Well, it's like, you know, you might subconsciously have known that song, but you're not in the moment. That's not why. You know, you're just feeling something. Like if you're singing over.
I'm never
going
to be able to listen to that song again now, though.
All right, so I'm 2 for 2.
You're 2 for 2, I mean...
Two, like,
I feel
one
like you
and
did
a half.
Your homework.
No, that was 100%. Okay. That's like 2.5.
We got 3.
All right. Okay, hold on. No, keep going.
Oh, you know it, bro.
Okay. I was
thirsting for knowledge. Just let it play.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because as soon as it plays, he'll be like, what? Yeah, you will.
Nah, I don't know if we're going to get this one, folks.
All right, everybody.
Okay.
It's coming
get it.
In. And one pretty chorus.
Hannah's probably sang it before the show.
Okay, yeah. That.
There, wait for it.
This is kind of ringing a bell. Oh. Is this Alison Krauss?
No.
No.
Then I don't know.
It's Strawberry Wine, Deanna Carter.
Okay, yeah. That's...
Not no.
Wasn't gonna
sorry. All right.
I'll take the L on that one. All
right, so we're 2 for 3.
Okay.
I got another one.
I'm just glad I got a cut. Okay, hold on. Keep it going. It's like I should have... Like everyone else like knows it right away. And I'm... You always had an eye for things that glitter. But I was far from being made of gold. Is this Tim McGraw?
Tim McGraw.
Yeah. I don't know how
You know the song.
A smile by Tim McGraw.
Just to see you smile.
Just to see you smile.
I was going to say, if he didn't know it, I was going to be like, if you had no idea anybody in country music, who's one country musician you could name?
Tim McGraw?
Yeah.
No, there's a few.
Okay, so we're 3 for 4. We'll do a few more.
Okay.
I like this game right now.
It's just growing.
Okay.
Tight,
is that Bad Brad Paisley?
Yeah. Oh, way off.
Yeah.
Be nice.
No, that's fine. No.
Fast as You, Dwight Yoakam.
No, wasn't going to get that.
All right.
what year, by the way? What years are
what
all these?
What year?
Songs? Yeah.
Dwight Yoakam might have been a little older.
Fast as You was probably like 91, something like that.
Okay, at least the early
90s.
Yeah, if we were heading towards late 90s, I'd probably do a little bit better. But
okay.
The only reason I thought you would have known Dwight Yoakam is because he's like the Bakersfield sound. So
oh,
it's
like California country.
Yeah.
Isn't he in a bunch of movies, too? He's in Wedding Crashers.
He's been doing a lot
he's in
of
the first scene of Wedding Crashers.
Really?
Yeah. And then I watched this movie the other night called Logan Lucky. He's in that, too.
I did see that. Logan Lucky was a
pretty
good movie.
Pretty dope movie, yeah.
Yeah, good.
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to do 4 more.
4 more?
Well, he's doing good.
We can do 3.
All right, whatever. Keep it going.
I want
to... I've definitely heard this song before.
I'm proud of you.
But I'm not going to get it. Oh, I definitely know this one. The girls, like, throw me off, though. It's like Trisha Yearwood. But
no.
It's not. It's not.
Yeah. Canadian.
Oh, it's Shania.
Yep.
I saw Shania at Stagecoach 2 years ago.
Was it great?
Honestly, it was awesome. I was like right in the like the standing room, like right in front of the stage. And when she sang From This Moment, I was I was like, I forgot about this song. Because she was like just playing banger after banger. And then she opened it up. She broke out with that. And I was like, this song is yo, it was like angelic. It was pretty sweet.
Yeah,
like,
that was
I think Shania was my first
It was
concert.
A moment. It was for sure a moment.
Good.
All my friends went back to the house, too. They're like, we didn't really want to see Shania. I was like, I'm staying for Shania.
Yeah.
And it was totally worth it. It was awesome.
Oh, man. Right. They let good drugs go to waste.
Yeah.
We got 3 more.
This sounds familiar. I'll bet you've never heard old Marshall Dillon say, Miss Kitty, have you ever thought of running away? Settling down, would you marry me? I wish I just had my phone just shazamming the whole time without you knowing. Keep this one going.
Okay.
I've heard the song. I just want to hear the chorus.
Been a cowboy.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
So the heat.
Yeah, all right. See, I knew it. Like, I know
been a
it.
Cowboy.
Big dog daddy.
Like, when the chorus kicked in, I was there with it. I was ready
to
go. I was like, all right. I remembered it. But
yeah.
But also, I suck.
So. I wouldn't say that,
I know you're being a really good sport, though. Like, you're doing well.
Yeah, well, I don't think I'm doing well. And I'm upset at myself for not doing well just because of my competitive nature. But
I can tell you definitely know him.
Yeah, I'm like, you know, my perk up. I perk up, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
You can see it in your eyes.
These are softballs, maybe.
I don't think there are any softballs unless these are the ones that are like.
Maybe I'm going to play. We'll go to the second one. Give me a second.
Should have drank another coffee.
Not okay.
As sharp as I usually am.
He's got a son on the radio.
So is this that ain't my truck?
Yes.
Red Akins.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Doing well. One last one. That one's too easy.
Thanks for that. That was a nice little
help me. Well, I mean, I wasn't going to give it to you. Ooh,
good choice. Last one right here.
Trucker's wife. The part she couldn't handle was being alone. I guess she needed more to hold than just a telephone. Papa called Mama each and every night just to ask her how she was and if his kids were alright.
I really want to get this one to the
men. And Daddy hang up, she was gone again. Mama was a girl, Lord, I was shy. Papa was building up the jail sky.
It's a car?
It's Garth.
Yeah!
Papa loved Mama.
Oh, man.
The pressure was on.
Beads of sweat.
Oh, man. Gosh.
That was like...
Hey, you can't do it on the top, champ.
That was like what? Russian roulette in Vietnam. God. Oh, man. I just had the chamber ready to go. I was like, please don't have a bullet in it. We got through it. We got through it.
What kind of music did you grow up listening to?
Not that. The first music I can remember listening to is Rod Stewart in the back of my dad's car when I was like probably like 3 or 4. And my parents listened to kind of classic rock music, like American classic rock or, you know, British classic rock. So I was raised, the first music I remember hearing was obviously my parents. And that was a lot of Rod Stewart, Billy Joel, the Rolling Stones, Fleetwood Mac, the Doors, Elton John. Little Beatles, kind of. I mean, we were more of a Stones family than a Beatles family. Yeah, I'd say those are kind of the core. And then some 80s music, like a lot of like one-hit wonders from the 80s. And then once I kind of got into my own stuff, I've always loved pop music, like popular music, whatever's.
Mm-hmm.
So like when Ace of Base was, I don't know how old you guys are, but my first tape that I ever bought. For those youngsters listening out there, I bought it. We had tapes before CDs. And the first tape I wanted to buy was Ace of Base. They had a couple big hits called The Sign. I saw the sign and it opened up my eyes. I saw the sign.
Okay.
Yep. And then the other one was The Proclaimers, who had a song called 500 Miles.
I would walk 500.
So those were the first two. And then The Spin Doctors. It was three. Those were the first three. So it was Ace of Base, The Proclaimers, and then The Spin Doctors, who had a song called Two Princes. That was a big song.
You spent your early whole 90s. Summer's allowance on all that.
Yeah. I mean, it was not all at once. It was kind of those were as the song like became popular on radio. You know, like I'd be in the back seat of the car, and whatever was popular on the radio, I'd take a liking to, and then
go.
Go
get that tape.
Tape.
Yeah. Rewind, play it again.
So that was like early 90s, and then I got into what else? Yeah, it was basically pop music up until I started getting into
Blink-182.
Yeah, Blink-182 was very pivotal in my music career.
Was that like your teenage angst years?
No, I was like in 7th grade, and I'm 12 years old, and they were like the biggest band I think in the world at that point, and I loved all their music, like everything about them, and I wanted to learn their songs on guitar, and they were kind of the reason I wanted to play guitar. So I got a guitar and basically learned, I think they had like 72 songs at the time, and I learned all of them. And that's kind of how I learned how to play guitar.
Oh my God.
That's a ton of songs.
That is dedication.
And then when you get into the guitar, it just opens up a whole new world, and you learn, you find out about tabs, and then, you know, you get really into guitar and guitarists. So like Jimi Hendrix then became a huge thing to me, and just learning songs on the guitar was like the coolest thing.
Oh yeah.
So from like Blink, it kind of transitioned into, but like that whole like pop punk era and kind of rock music from like anything kind of that's an offshoot of that sort of early 2000s pop punk. And then got a little bit older and like got into high school, and like John Mayer started becoming like huge, and Dave Matthews, man. And Dave Matthews Band was the new, he was like, he became my idol. I became like the biggest Dave Matthews Band fan. And then I wanted to learn all his songs, and I want to learn all the John Mayer songs. And that's kind of, you know, basically kind of evolved, you know.
So, I mean, if you know all these songs, you're pretty good guitar player.
Yeah, well, that's what kind of got my foot in the door into writing songs, because I had all these different sort of elements from guitar. Like, a lot of kids, I guess, just, like, learn, like, blues and, like, they get really into that. But I was, like, learning, like, pop punk songs, which actually at their core, like, very pop melodically. And then I was doing these kind of, like, folky songs. Like, I was learning, like, the Dave Matthews and John Mayer kind of, like, singer-songwriter, like, more finger-picking, cool, riffy type stuff. And then when I started, like, writing for myself, it was always, like, based around the riff and coming up with a cool riff. And that's kind of, like, what got my foot in the door to writing songs, is because I could just sit there on the guitar and just rattle off, you know, what I thought would be, you know, catchy riffs or song starters, and that, like, something that would just be like, what was that? Like, what, play that again? And then,
I mean, I just sort of evolved. And you'll hear somebody play, like, just something cool. It's like, is that already something?
Right, yeah. And so there was a lot of that. And then I kind of knew I was, like, on to something. Like, we're good. That's kind of just how it sort of evolved. And then once I started getting into music, like, professionally, I stopped listening to music.
You just kind of stopped listening?
Yeah, I don't know, like new artists, and I think it was, like, kind of halfway through college when I started, like, transitioning into, like, trying to make my own music or trying to make music for other people that, like, I kind of fell off. Because, like, Pandora, I remember, like, had just launched when I was, like, a freshman in college, and that was, like, the coolest thing, because you could just go to the next song and Pandora actually introduced me to a bunch of new music.
I still listen to Pandora.
Yeah, I mean, it's terrible for songwriters, and, like, they're like, I guess they're like not, they don't really support songwriters that well. But I did, like, I learned about, like, My Morning Jacket, which is a band kind of out of here, like, through them. And I just remember, like, Tame Impala, just, like, weird, like, kind of indie stuff that they put. Kings of Leon, when I became, like, the biggest Kings of Leon fan when I found out about them. Yeah, I get real into something. And, like, I super fan. Like, currently I'm, like, a super fan of Hardy's.
Okay, I just saw Hardy last night for the first time.
I saw him on Friday in New York City, and it was amazing. I haven't, like, fangirled like that for an artist. I mean, my brother and I went to see the Rolling Stones in August, and we fanned out because they're the Rolling Stones. But, like, anybody that's, like, my generation and, like, new artists, like, I don't get, like, psyched. Because you kind of get jaded in a way, so, like, I've been to Coachella a bunch and Stagecoach and all these things, and you see all these people that are kind of in the same class or, like, age range as you, and it's hard to get excited because you're like, I'm, like, in it too, and like, I see the behind the scenes stuff, but Hardy. That is my guy. I am a fan. Like, I fan out, and I'll go to the ends of the earth for that guy. I'm, like, I'm a devoted fan.
I did see him. He played the AIBA conference. It's, like,
the bookers and everyone. Yeah, I saw that. How many songs did he play?
5. But those guys are so hard to entertain in that room because everyone's in there and they're just talking. Stuffy. And, like, it's a weird vibe. Like, everyone's there to network and you're just kind of
that,
there.
That conference is for what? That's for, like, bookers and so stuff?
There's bookers, the agents.
Yeah.
And then venues. And, like, I went.
Yeah.
And I had a good time. But, like, when Hardy played, people had their phones out. People were singing along.
He puts on a show. He's like a rock star.
Him. And, like, not that they weren't watching the previous, like, there was before, but no one engaged the crowd like he did.
He puts on a fucking show.
I'm pretty sure they turned the volume way when he went
to turned
stage.
It up to 11 for Hardy. He's the man. I'm a huge fan of
him. Have you written with him yet?
No. That'd be a dream. I'd love to. I just want to be friends with the guy.
I don't know where he hangs out. Like, I've never seen him around town.
Nah, he's just on his way. I think he's on tour or whatever he's doing. I should know as a super fan, you know. He's actually in Alabama tonight. Just truly is.
Is he? Really? Yeah, he's not.
Well, I would know. I follow him on Instagram. I saw he was in Alabama. You know, I'm not, you know. Whatever. Guy's in Alabama. He's playing a show. So.
He's a super fan.
Oh, he's a cool cat, man.
Yeah, he seems like a cool cat. I love his music. I just think he's really smart and fun, and he makes rock music really isn't a thing anymore. And he's got songs that kind of
have
fill
a lot
that
of
gap. And I'm a huge rock fan. I love rock music. I love Tool. Oh my God, talk about a band that I'm also
most
devoted
recent
to.
Record they put out. Listen to it.
Oh yeah, I love it. I love it. They can do no wrong in my eyes. Mm-hmm. I think they're awesome. And like they have songs that change time signatures like 16 times. And I don't know how they play them live and remember. They're like 12-minute songs, and it changes a gazillion times. I don't know how they do it. They're brilliant. They're so good. So that's another band that I would, like, go to the end of the earth for. So, yeah.
Hardy's a cool cat, man. You could totally get in a room with him.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, we'll let the cards fall as they may. We'll see what happens. So, yeah. How we doing?
So on each podcast, we also do off-the-record confessions.
Oh.
So they're actually on the record.
Yeah.
I just say that because some people think they're going to be off.
Right.
But just kind of something like weird or embarrassing about yourself. Like, if you have any like weird things you do, have an embarrassing
so
story.
So it doesn't have to be, you know, I went to bed till I was 20.
Right.
It can be like last time or one time Jenna did one where she ate Chick-fil-A topless because she...
not topless.
Because she didn't want to get her sweater dirty.
I was driving. I took off my sweater. I had on a bra.
That's
kind of... It was a nice sweater. It was expensive.
I mean, she was still in the drive-thru, but...
I left the drive-thru.
embarrassing.
I wore that sweater the other night, and I ate... It was a lunch meeting I was having, and I was trying to eat... And it's so hard to eat at meetings anyway because you're trying to talk. Mm-hmm. But you're, like, actually hungry because you haven't eaten all day. And you probably, like, it's in the middle of the conference. I had that sweater on. And it's, like, a $200 sweater.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And, like, you're not supposed to wash it that often. Like, it's nice.
Yeah, no. That's
and
like
it's got, like, big sleeves.
Yeah.
And I'm, like, trying to eat. And I'm, like, dang, I just wish I could take my sweater off again.
Right.
And bring it under your shirt.
Yeah, you don't want to ruin a nice piece.
No.
God, embarrassing. They put me on the spot here even though it was... Was that in the thing? Was that there?
Oh, okay. It's okay. It's all good.
I think I'm doing okay. But embarrassing. Man. Okay. Well, this is kind of embarrassing. I don't know if it's like, I forgot if I should even say it, but it's just like, it was a funny thing that happened the other day, a couple weeks ago, that was, I guess, slightly embarrassing for both parties involved. I don't even know if it's really worth mentioning though. Okay, why don't you go pick up this coffee table? And
sounds like a dizzy.
I don't know. Why don't you go pick up this coffee table from, you know, I bought it off Facebook Marketplace and it was this amazing coffee table. And I go to meet the woman at her house and her husband's standing behind her. And I notice that he has no legs. And
okay, like Lieutenant Dan?
Yeah, kind
of. So he wasn't standing behind her?
No, he was. He was standing. He wasn't in...
Oh, okay.
He had like the Oscar Pistol, like the...
Yeah,
the,
magic
like
legs.
The, yeah, like
okay.
The cool ones.
Okay.
See, I don't know. And then, so anyways, I go, whatever. I don't go to, you know, and then I go to shake his hand. Guy's got no hands. And I go, oh, no. I was like, oh, man. And like, I'm trying to like... You know, this is the first time I'm seeing the coffee table, and I thought I was gonna buy it, but now I'm like, I gotta buy it. Like, I have to buy the coffee table. And like, there, you know, there was a problem. I wasn't even gonna negotiate the price. I was whatever. Like, I just like need to get out of there. And so, we're talking. I'm like trying to make eye contact with everybody, and like,
yeah, he's got no eyes.
I'm just trying to like keep it cool and like pretend like I know I totally don't notice that you have no hands and no legs, and so we're finishing up shooting the shit and like, and he's like, yeah man, I'm so happy you could be buying this coffee table, and I'm like, yeah man, I'm so glad I could take it off your hands. So whoops,
yeah.
Gotta go. So yeah, I gave him the cash and got the hell out of there. So that was pretty embarrassing.
That actually was a lot better than I thought.
Yeah, I know. I wasn't going to say the story. I just didn't know. I'm not trying to be offensive or whatever. That's just what happened because it's like such a natural. You
can't laugh at yourself.
Yeah, I was just. Yeah, that's just something you say. I'm glad I could take it off your hands.
Yeah.
And then once it's coming out, what are you supposed to do?
I was playing downtown one time. I think like Honky Tonk Central. And it was the first song of the day, and I look out to the crowd, and I was like, I'm going to play a song for y'all, and I started playing Keep Your Hands to Yourself, and the only person that was, like, paying attention was somebody that had no hands.
Oh, man.
And I was just like, do I stop playing?
No, look, it's not, you know, what are you going to do?
I don't know.
You didn't plan for that. You didn't think
somebody with no
hands was going to show up.
I feel like you can't feel like at fault.
No, exactly. Yeah. I didn't, but it was just, you know, if I could take it back, I would.
Sounds
have
to
it.
Me like you but were very gentlemanly.
Yes.
And
paid full price.
Paid full price. How's the coffee table look?
It's amazing. Totally, like, way better than what was there.
Did it cost an arm and a leg?
It did for him. But
I always try to shop on Facebook Marketplace and I never find anything good.
Yeah,
I'm a terrible Facebook Marketplace shopper.
I didn't when I first moved here. I didn't necessarily know where I'd end up or whatever. So I didn't want to like go all in on certain things. But yeah, I found my couch and my coffee table and a couple other things. Honestly, it's a great place, that marketplace. Because you can find some gems. Oh, the coffee table was $1,400. I looked at they had like a tag on the bottom of it, like the serial number and everything. So I like looked it up. And yeah, it retails for like $1,400, and I got it for $150. So
I thought you said you paid $1,400.
Nah, bro.
Damn.
Nah. That marketplace, bro. Marketplace. Shit, man.
You be opening up an antique store here soon.
Yeah. Yeah, I was thinking just resell it for like $800 or whatever, $1,000.
Yeah.
Sorry, guys. Should have sold. Yeah. I don't know. I don't know why he sold it so low, but yeah, thing's great, sturdy.
Fantastic. They just had no idea how much it was worth.
Really ties everything together.
Yeah.
So. That's so funny. Yeah.
All right. Where can everyone follow you? Are you active on social media?
Yeah, I kind of go in spurts, kind of ebbs and flows. I'm more of a story guy. I love storying. Sometimes I'll catch a nice creative wave with my stories every now and then, and I think it can be pretty entertaining.
So Facebook stories, Instagram
stories. Okay. Yeah, Facebook. I don't know what's going on other than the marketplace.
He's only on Facebook for that marketplace.
Yeah, that's the only reason. That's the only thing. Yeah, now, Facebook's kind of like for moms.
I was saying that the other day. Old people took over Facebook.
I love when like my mom or like my mom's friend will like post a picture, and then the comment section of like a suburban mother's Facebook is hysterical. It's like people like, you know, like looking great, Donna, and then it's like thanks, Betty, and then like someone else chimes in and like they'll like, or it's just like they can have like little mini conversations within the comment section. And it's just like so corny. And
what makes me mad is like, I mean, we're all in the music industry. We all try to like take and put time and effort into our social media.
Yeah.
My dad could give two shits less about his Facebook, but if he posts a picture about anything,
yeah,
it's got 100 likes, 100 comments. You know, I could upload like, hey, just released a new album. Yeah. You know,
12 years. Yeah, dad's popping on Insta.
Yeah,
you can find me on Instagram. That's kind of Twitter. Well,
I saw your Twitter.
Yeah, if you're smart, you'll put two and two together. It's the same at. It's just Dave Kuncio, KUNCIO.
You're also on your Twitter. You're getting catfished.
I am.
Well, you were like a while
ago. Oh yeah, somebody.
He's catfishing people.
No, somebody was using my pictures to catfish people in Connecticut.
I hope it's on the show.
I actually know Neve. I know Neve. I met Neve right after he got catfished, and he's a friend of my publisher's. And
did you send your story?
I texted my publisher the day it happened. I go, you got to hit Neve up and tell him that someone's using my pictures to catfish people in Connecticut.
He was like, this is hysterical.
I thought it was all made up.
It was crazy. When I met Neve, it was right after they had just finished shooting the documentary, and they were just starting to like shop it around at like film festivals, and he was like, yeah, like we're going to this film festival, like we did this documentary, this crazy thing happened where I was like talking to this girl and it turned out to be this totally different thing, and it was like, he's like, yeah, like it's starting to pick up some steam, I think, and like it's doing well in these film festivals, and then literally like a year later it was like everywhere.
Yeah.
I was like, what?
Yeah.
I was like, yeah. So someone was using my pictures, great pics, but I think they were really tasteful pics, I think, that he used. But he was using my pictures to catfish girls because a girlfriend of mine texted me and was like, my best friend's wife texted me and said, my friend just saw you on this app, but you don't live in Connecticut and your name isn't Kevin or whatever the hell the guy's name was. Yeah. And I was like, you got to send me this immediately. So I don't know if the guy was, you know, if he's still doing it, if, you know.
My thing is.
Jury's still out on the guy.
My question is.
But I'm flattered.
If you catfish somebody. And
what's the end game, you know?
Heaven forbid you were to knock them up and then ghost them. Are they going to come looking for you or the guy that catfished?
So say that again.
So like, so like they know your face from all social media, but then it's a different person. And then they meet up, have a nice romantic evening in the dark. And then the next morning, and then the next morning, the girl blind. You're gone.
never sees the guy's face. It's like, come in. You're saying like he's
he
like
might,
yeah,
he might child support.
Yeah.
I did listen to a story once where these two twins were like switching places on a girl, and they both had to pay her child support when she got knocked up because they couldn't. They're identical twins, and they couldn't figure out which one actually was the baby.
Daddy. Oh no, she's a genius. She's like, I'm gonna get a tip
two for one. One. Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. I hope that's not the case. I hope I don't have any.
Oh no, your kids are probably somewhere on a beach.
Yeah. All right.
Let's hope.
We're gonna wrap it up. You guys can follow Inside the Noize at Inside the Noize with a Z. Listen on iTunes, Spotify. Everywhere you want. Find Dave at the Red Door.
Yeah, or anywhere.
Or listening room.
Yeah. Or just, you know, just your neighborhood corner store.
And this podcast was recorded at the Songmill, East Nashville's newest home for artists, songwriters, and podcasters.
You heard?
Okay, bye.
That's it.
Are we good?